Tonight on Access TV, it's Gotham Comedy Live. Get ready to laugh with Norrie Davis, Karen Morgan, Giulio Gallerati, John Moses. This week's host, Dom Herrera. Gotham Comedy Live, all happening right now. Ladies and gentlemen, Dom Herrera!
Hi, hi, hello, oy vey, I'm Dom Herrera, welcome to Gotham Comedy Live. How are you? Thank you for coming out in this brutally cold weather for a laugh, because let's face it, you need a laugh or you wouldn't be here. If you could still make her laugh, you'd be home getting late, but you got to come for laughs, right? That's all you got. I love you people. I got to tell you, I love people. I don't care what you are. I'm a Catholic. I'm Italian. I'm from Philly. I don't care if you're a Buddhist, a Hindu, a Muslim, German, Jewish, or even Hebrew. It doesn't matter to me. You're all wrong anyway. You're wrong about God. You're wrong about Jesus. Jesus doesn't love you. Jesus loves me. A Catholic priest once told me that while he's buttoning up my little pants. We try and make things that are painful funny. Child molestation is obviously a horrible, hideous thing, but there's a flip side to everything. What about the kids like me who wanted to be molested and nobody would touch? What about that kind of pain? Remember my grandmother would give me a bath. She was so kind and loving and tactile. I said, Grandma, just tickle my little balls with that feather touch. Just cup them. Guess their weight. Beasel and nozzle my little pink doggy dingleberry. Let me see your tits. I'll give you $1. $2. $2 if you let me teabag you. I love you, Nana. We lost my grandmother. She didn't die. We lost her. She actually shrunk to the point we can't find her anymore. It's so sad. We know she's still in the house. She's just not visible to the naked eye. All we hear out of the rug is, Bafangula, Bafangula, you guys. I'm going to tell you something. It's good to come out for a laugh. Laughter is the best medicine, right? Other than medicine. Medicine's the best medicine. That's why they call it medicine. What are you, fucking retarded? Laughter's nice. Once you get 102 fever, I would suggest an antibiotic over a joke book. I'm just saying. So anyway, Bill Cosby started raping me in the summer of 84. And he continued to plunge my anus. You know, I'm so conditioned now, I can't climax unless I hear Fat Albert's voice. That's a true story, ladies and gentlemen. I love when comedians say true story like you give a fuck. Hey, how about something funny you made up? Because your true story is to tell you the truth to put me to sleep. Why don't you bullshit like those other comedians? Like you're going to walk out of here tonight and go, well, all the acts were good except that guy Dom Herrera. He wasn't really funny. But talk about integrity. My God, all he did was tell one unfunny truth after another. I've never seen anything so unfunny. I'm a comedian. I'm older than a lot of you people, believe it or not, as good as I look, as cute as I am. And I see you, and you look like angels to me. That's the greatest thing about getting older. I look at you, you're like an angel, like floating through the atmosphere to torture men. Look at that. Well, and that's the greatest thing is, as you get older, more and more women look beautiful to you because you naturally lower the bar in the sense that, not for nothing, a lot of you girls, let's face it, are average or less than average. Even a little skanky, a little stinky. But with that said, you look good to me because I'm not as hot as I was. Quite frankly, 15 years ago, I wouldn't crook my neck at some of you wildebeest bitches. And I say that with all due respect. I don't even care about a woman's face anymore. All I care about is the body. She could have the head of a goat. She's got a nice body. Did you see the ass on that goat-headed woman? Forget about it. Tell you what, she files those horns and trims that goatee. Not a bad-looking girl. Women can fake a lot of shit. Men have trouble faking. One thing you can't fake is an erection. You can't lie about an erection. You're either hard or you're not. You can't go, baby, I love you. Yeah, do you? But you know, I don't turn you on anymore. You totally turn me on. But you're not hard. What are you going to say? Yes, I am. No, you're not. I'm staring right down the barrel. No, babe, I'm hard. You're just looking at it from the right angle. Go over there and take a gander at that rock tube of love. We always protect our girls, right? The thing is, we got to protect the girls. We don't give a fuck about the boys. They go out, they get drugged, somebody blows them on a cat. Nobody gives a shit. We protect our girls. You never hear a father bragging about his daughter's sexual prowess. You hear it up there? That's my daughter taking on 10 guys. Listen to her screaming in the night like a wild banshee. I'm telling you, that kid always loved cock. She always loved cock. She's always had men lined up around a block, guys tag-teaming her from behind. High-fiving over a jizz-filled back, dropping loads in her ear so she can't hear what they're saying. What can I tell you, huh? She's just like her mother, that kid. She's like her mother and her grandmother before her. God rest her stretched-out, gray, cobweb twat of love. Are you up there, Granny? Can you hear me? Grandmom died, but she's in a better place. Isn't that the biggest bullshit in life, better place? How do we know what happens after we die? You know what a better place is for sure? Maui. Maui's a better place. You been to Hawaii? Anybody ever been to Hawaii? No matter, It's so beautiful. It's so enchanted. No matter what happens, people don't even listen to you. Hey, man, how you doing? I just got back from Hawaii. Broke my leg in 4 places, surfboard. My wife got bitten in the ass by a shark. We lost a little puppy in a volcano. You should have seen him waving his unknowing paws. He spiraled into the abyss. Really? You were in Hawaii? Cool. Thank you for that partial applause break. I don't go for the whole crowd. I like little spins and smathers of people laughing. There's a beautiful Asian woman. Beautiful Asian woman. I've never been with an Asian woman for free, but let me tell you something. Give me a little of this. A little of that. Yeah, you know, I know I'm getting close to the end of my life. I don't look good. I don't look good. I looked in the mirror. I figure if I work out, if I stretch, if I eat right, maybe I got a month and a half. Maximum. But I try, you know, it's like I said, I'm trying to gain weight, right? I got to gain weight. It's hard, you know, I fall asleep eating with the pizza on my chest. It's hard to gain weight because, you know, I got to gain 35 pounds by the end of February for a part in a movie. I don't know what that movie is. Hopefully something comes up. And it's some guy, 35 pounds. I realized that I couldn't even be gay now. Because I couldn't get in gay shape. I couldn't do the ab work to be gay. You know what I mean? It's like, if I tried to come out of the closet, two big, strong fucking gay guys would throw me back in. Get the fuck back in there, you old fart. You had your chance when you were in your 20s. It's a lot of work. I always love it. It's so different, like gay guys and gay women, because guys are always going, man, I love nothing hotter than two chicks together. No, nothing hotter than two hot chicks together. Believe me, you don't want to see Bertha and Anna down by the dock pumping it in as the tugboats are pulling in. Ooga. You never hear women wanting to see two guys together. Allison, would I love to see Gus blow Big Vic? Maybe I'm just a hopeless romantic. Wouldn't it be nice if little Gussie just staggered to his knees and start whomping and chomping on Vic's chub? Is it hot or is it me? We like those lipstick lesbians. That's what we like. Those articles about the two co-eds lounging around a dorm in high heels and lingerie, studying. That's why most girls at college study. Allison, you want to study? She, I don't know, Bridget. Let me put some stripper pumps on and some crotchless edible underwear. Maybe that'll get me in the mood to read some anthropology with you. And they get so bored, they start sexually experimenting with each other. I can't imagine. I can't fathom getting that bored with one of my friends. I gotta tell you, George, this game sucks, man. 48-0 halftime, I'm bored. But I got an idea. I got an idea, Georgie boy. Don't you worry, I'll drive you home. You won't be able to walk anyway when I get done. Guys, we have a great show for you tonight. We have four acts on the show. They're all terrific, except one's a dud. Anyway, love you, man.
Stay tuned for more laughs on Access TV, live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City. Corey Davis is taking the stage when we return.
Everybody, please welcome to the stage Norrie Davis. He's got an album out now. It's called Home Game. Norrie Davis, give him a hand. All right.
Yeah, turn up.
You're still clapping.
Thank you, yo. Thank you. How you guys doing? Doing good? That's what's up, man. Good. I'm feeling all right, man. Going through a breakup, man. Shit fucking sucks. Yeah, but it's all right. It was me. I fucked up. Because I got, like, commitment. I'm scared. Like, I see, like, couples right there. Like, y'all on each other. Like, that's cute. I want to do that. And then I'm like, nah, fuck that. I tried, man. And it's so hard that, you know, you break up, then you try to get back with the girl, and then she don't want to get back with you. That's the worst right there. And breakups, this was such, I think breakups are worse for guys than ladies, because ladies got girlfriends. I'm saying, that those y'all Ninja Turtles. You know what I'm saying? Donnie, Ralph, Leo, Mike, they got your back. You could just start crying. You know, I fucking hate him. I hope he fucking dies. And your girl comes in like, look, stop crying, girl. We gonna go out. We gonna get some drinks. Matter of fact, I'm gonna get my bitch ass boyfriend to drive us. We gonna use all his gas. You know, y'all my power circle. Let's take an Instagram pic. Y'all got that, man. You can't talk to your boys over a girl that you love and lost and trying to get back. They don't take you serious. Like, yo, man, I love her, man. How could I get her back? Your boy look you right in your eye and go, word. You know what you need? More bitches. Yeah, we going to a strip club. Let's go. Sit there. Get a lap dance. Now you're in the strip club getting a lap dance crying. I ain't want this, man. Yo, stop crying, man. You're getting tears down the crack of my ass. Stop it. What's wrong with you?
Okay, I'm sorry. Make it rain.
Are you crying on her booty?
It's so soft.
It's the worst. That was me, man. My boys left me in the strip club. They left me in there for a couple months. Seriously. They never came and got me. I was pissed the fuck off. But your boys always come through for you when you about to do something stupid, right? Hey, yo, man, wait, what are you doing? Is that the stripper from the club? You gonna bring in your house on Thanksgiving? And introduce to your mama? You got glitter all over your face! Do you even know her fucking name? Sprinkles, man. I love Sprinkles. You gonna bring Sprinkles in your house on Thanksgiving, introduce your... All right, I should slap the shit out of you. Are you serious? Are y'all even on a committed relationship? Are y'all even having sex? Well, I can't afford that right now, but... We're gonna work out a plan. Everything be all right. And it's hard to get out of that mode. I was in that mode for a little bit. Guys go through this mode. Women do too, but it's the worst. Guys go through this mode called zombie dick. That's when you can't meet nobody else. You can't get out of that fun. That's when your dick is not connected to your heart or your head. You know what I'm saying? Girls like, hey, you're cute. You. Gotta shoot it down like The Walking Dead, two in the dick, two in the head. Gone. But it's good, man. I'm back on the dating scene, man. And what's great about the dating scene? Sex. Let me tell you something about sex. I'm not a freaky dicky dude, man. I don't like it. I met this one girl, she loved having sex in the shower. I hate it. I know people love it. I hate that shit because the women having a great time, man. They, you know, they bent over, the water's hitting their back, but then it goes in my eyes, and I can't see any. Can we stop? I want to stop. She's all like Michael Phelps. Come on, motherfucker, bring her. I can't see any. Can we go to dry land, please? I can't see. I'm real simple with sex, real simple. My boys always talked about it, man. I know I'm going kind of hard in the beginning of the show, but anal sex, ugh, disgusting. I'm with the ladies on that. That shit's disgusting. Look at the guys. Yo, shut the fuck up, man. Man, why are you knocking? You ain't trying. Nah, it's nasty. I can't do it, man. I'll never do it because I can't get over the fact that my dick is brown, so it looks like I'm putting poop back in her butt. I'm not shit. I'm a man. And you want this doo-doo dick? I'm not giving you doo-doo dick. Don't do it. It's real good, man. But like the highlight of sex for everybody, man, women and men, or orgasm. Orgasm is dope. It is, man. You know it's really good when they say your name. Oh, Nori! They were. I hope you guys experience that. They're not saying your name. Keep going. You'll get there, brother. But like, you understand the feeling when they say your name, right? That's the equivalent. When you hear they say your name during sex, you just want to get off top of her and then just start walking in slow motion. And then she blows up behind you. Come on, man. Right. It's over. What happened to your girl? She blew up, man. I gotta get another one. You know me, baby. Blowing up bitches. The ladies get the same experience. Like, for God, like, we can't say your name during sex. That's some bitch shit, right? Like, oh, Jessica, what? Oh, my God. Oh, Jessica, shit, you. Oh, this pussy's okay. All right. I'm gonna need you to take this pussy and calm down. Oh, oh God. Chill, you can't. You can tell we feeling it when we just start buying you everything. You come home, you got a new HDTV. You got HBO Go for no reason. We got you Amazon Prime and Netflix. This is all for you, baby. You doing your thing. Like, oh, really? Oh, my God. I didn't ask for none of this. Oh, but you know. And then that's when she starts walking in slow motion. And our bank account blows up behind her. Oh, my pussy made it rain. Thank you. You guys are dope, man. I'm Norie Davis, man. Thank you guys so much, man. Yo, get that home game, baby.
Stay tuned for more laughs on Access TV, live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City. Karen Morgan is taking the stage when we return. Presentation of Gotham Comedy Live. More laughs right now.
Oh my God. Oh my God. Y'all are awesome. Y'all are awesome. I gotta tell y'all first, I am from Georgia. Y'all may be able to tell. When I go out to supper with my mother, she will order a Coke to drink. And if the person says, I'm sorry, we don't have Coke products. Is Pepsi okay? Instead of suffering through 18 ounces of Pepsi like the rest of us, my mother will explain that Pepsi is made in New Jersey by Yankees. Coca-Cola is made in Atlanta by God. Coca-Cola comes in a red can. I vote in a red state. Pepsi comes in a can that looks a whole lot like President Barack Obama's campaign symbol, if you ask me. So no, Pepsi is not okay. Do you have alcohol? Just bring me a Jack and Coke and just hold the damn Coke. So I went to y'all's crazy Whole Foods here. Oh my God, I got lost. You can't get out of that place. They won't let you out of it. The little girl at the checkout line, they have a new marketing campaign that collard greens are the new kale. I said, well, my family puts collard greens in bacon grease until they oink and they no longer resemble a vegetable. Yeah. She said, I don't know what you're saying to me. I'm vegan. I made her cry. Sad little vegan girl. I recently went to my very first Civil War reenactment. That's a good time. And because it was my first one, I wanted to find out what was going to happen. So I walked over to some of the guys in the gray uniforms. I said, so, how's it going to go today? And this one guy very seriously looked at me and goes, well, we don't win. But see this is my friend Greg. Greg has a whole lot of fake blood. And when the battle starts, Greg puts all sorts of blood all over himself. Greg dies real good. I don't die so good anymore. It hurts my back to die hard. So I just ease myself down onto the ground, and then I take out my iPhone, and then I can videotape the skirmish while I'm down there. And then another guy came through on a horse, and he was wearing a blue uniform. And Greg got all red in the face and started screaming out, go to hell, Sherman! Ah! And I'm like, Greg, man, you're going to have a real heart attack on this fake battlefield. Come on, man, 150 years. Let it go, Princess Elsa. Just let it go. Come on. I live up in Maine now. I live up in Maine, which is the south of the north. Awesome. Good place to live. I love it there. We had a guy up there that took off every stitch of his clothes, got into his dump truck, and then drove his dump truck through the front wall of another guy's house. Then he got out of the dump truck and started to fight the guy that lived in the house. The guy in the house took out a hammer and just beat the shit out of the naked guy. And when he was interviewed, the guy in the house said, well, I was in my living room, and thankfully, I keep a hammer there. Just for this kind of situation. Like, he went to the hardware store and said, I am looking for a tool For if I'm in my living room watching the Patriots game and a dump truck comes through the front of my house and then a naked guy high on drugs gets out and starts to fight me, what kind of tool do you think I should buy for that? And they said, oh, that would be a Stanley number 10 ball peen hammer. Aisle 6, good luck to you. I travel. My travel tip is if you ever lose your luggage when traveling, you want it to happen in Charlotte, North Carolina. Because in Charlotte at the airport, they have a guy that works in the lost your luggage office whose name is Carlton. And Carlton just loves lost luggage. I went in there and he said, oh, can I help you? I said, I've lost my luggage. He said, oh, do you have your baggage claim check? I said, yes. He goes, oh, let's look it up in the computer. Okay. And then he looked something up on the computer and he said, Miss Morgan, it says here, your bag was scanned onto the plane, but not off of the plane. Carlton, what does that mean? It means it's lost. I was like, okay, what do we do now? Like, what's the next step? He goes, you know what? They're unloading another plane right now. Maybe your bag is on that one. Carlton, where's that plane coming from? Chicago. I said, I just came from Portland, Maine. I don't think my bag's going to be on a plane from Chicago. And then he said to me, and I quote, crazier things have happened here at United Airlines. And then he grabbed my hand like we were going to go to the county fair for fried dough. And we just skipped merrily over to the baggage carousel where the third bag off the plane from Chicago was my suitcase. And I said, I don't understand how this has possibly happened. I came from Portland, Maine to Charlotte. How did my bag go from Portland to Chicago and then to Charlotte? And then he said to me, maybe your bag just wanted to take a separate vacation. I said, Carlton, I love you. I still don't understand. He goes, well, Miss Morgan, it's like this. It's like when you go drinking with a bunch of friends and you're out drinking and you're doing shooters and you're getting drunk and then you lose somebody in your group. And then you worry for a while that maybe Mary Beth is getting raped or strangled in the parking lot. And then you have some more shooters and some more drinks. And then you forget that Mary Beth is getting raped or strangled in the parking lot. And then you leave the first bar and you go to the second bar. And guess who is standing there just smoking a cigarette waiting for you? Mary Beth. Mary Beth is your suitcase. Enjoy Charlotte, North Carolina. Awesome. Crazy. Carlton. So I just turned 50 a few months ago. And thank you. Thank you. Working on that. Here's the greatest thing about 50. I was at Target. We had a snowstorm up in Maine. Normally they have a towel there to wipe the snow out of the carts. Got there a particular afternoon. No towels. All the carts were wet. Little girl standing there in her little khaki pants and her little Target shirt. Amanda. And I was like, there's no towels here. She goes, oh, well, they're still wet from last night. I said, well, what am I supposed to do? She goes, oh, you could go in the bathroom and wipe them out with paper towels. Well, my 30-year-old self would have gone in the bathroom and wiped it out with paper towels. My 40-year-old self would have called Amanda's manager. We would have had a little to-do in the front, and Amanda would have had a little thing about customer service. My 50-year-old self took my shopping cart directly to the first clothing section that I came to. And just lined it with little boys' t-shirts and just kept on shopping. It's very fun. Very fun. I'm 50. So last year, some girlfriends and I, we went down to Mardi Gras to celebrate our 50th birthdays. Mardi Gras is awesome. Everyone should go at some point in their lives. We got titty beads. Woo! No, you show your titties, you get the beads. Ladies, you don't have to actually show your tits to get the beads. If somebody in your group blows the guy, they'll give you a whole box of beads. Awesome. We're married. We only blow people if we want something. And apparently we wanted Mardi Gras beads. And at this point in our lives, we would rather blow a stranger than show our tits in public. So I'm Karen Morgan. Thank y'all so much. Have a great night.
Stay tuned for more laughs on Access TV, live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City. Giulio Gallarotti is taking the stage when we return.
I got a 30-second joke. Woman's at a gynecologist examiner. He says to her, you have the largest vagina I've ever seen. You have the largest vagina I've ever seen. She says, you didn't have to say it twice. He says, I didn't. And now for his TV debut, Giulio Gallerani. Giulio. Give Giulio a hand.
Hello. Thank you. This is great, man. I was hanging out with my grandmother the other day, and she's funny because she's not racist, she's just old. You guys know about that? It is a thing. Like, she'll just say stuff that sounds incredibly racist, and people will just be like, oh, she just can't see well. But it's true, like, she can't. So, it's funny, she'll say stuff, and I'm always not sure as to why it sounds racist, but it always does. For example, one time I'm sitting at home watching TV, she comes and peers over my shoulder, she's like, Julie, are you watching rap videos? She's like, you kids and your rap videos. And I'm like, that's the president. And she's just like, oh, very funny, and just leaves the room. So it was never resolved. So I was like, all right, maybe she just couldn't see it, or like maybe she forgot Obama was the president. But she definitely remembered that encounter, because since then, every time I've introduced her to a black person, she's like, oh, let me guess, this is the president too? That's awkward. It's funny too, like, the last girlfriend of mine she remembers is my girlfriend from high school, so now every girlfriend is still the girl from high school, which is kind of awkward also. The girl I'm seeing now, she goes to fashion school. She goes to FIT. Which I'm not a big fan of the school because of a story she told me. She said one time, like, a speaker came in from Chanel and addressed the student body. And she was sitting in the front row with her bag. And the lady's like, guys, I've been working in fashion for a very long time, and it is my professional opinion that this woman has the worst fake Chanel bag I've ever seen. She's like, you should be ashamed of yourself. She's like, you might want to get out of here. I was like, that's horrible. That's the worst thing I've ever heard. I was like, that would never happen at any other school's guest speaker. Right? Like, I can't imagine medical school, a doctor's up there. He's like, I've been in medicine for a long time, and it is my professional opinion that this man has the worst prosthetic leg I've ever seen. You should be ashamed of yourself walking around on that thing. What are you, a pirate? Yeah, that's right. Get out of here, man, if you can. That clearly never happened. It's insane, man. I sit at home a lot during the day. I just try to write these jokes. You know? So I leave the news on in the background, and like lately the news is just really, really stressing me out, because I don't know if you ever watch CNN, but they only show like commentators, like they don't really cut to like the field that often. So it's just like Wolf Blitzer, like from this close, yelling stressful things about like a death count of children. And I'm like, this is awful. Like, I need a new news channel that delivers it in a more like relaxing fashion. I think the BBC has accomplished that. It's the same news, but they do it with a cadence where like anything is perfectly fine. Like, the same story that used to stress me out, they come on, they're like, the bus heading for Jakarta carrying 125 children was found, but none survived. I'm just like, all right. Right? Like, that's genius. Like, I wish I could have thought of something like that as a kid when I would get in trouble with my parents. Like, some smooth delivery. My parents are like, Julio, we saw your report card. What happened? And I'm like, it was going really well, but then I failed every class. God, man. I just had to buy a car. It was a pain. It's funny, like, I live in New York, so like I don't really drive. So now having to drive again, like, I've just realized things that I used to hate about driving. One of them is like when I'm trapped in the car with people who like think they know the words to every song. It's terrible, especially because like they don't know the words, so it's like them just making noise over popular hits from the past 20 years. Like, there's the songs that'll set them off are like Seal, Kiss from a Rose. Yeah. If you guys remember that song, the song comes on, the guy just, he can't even help it, he just kind of looks over, he's like, ba-da-da. But did you know? I'm like, you need to stop, dude. You're really stressing me out. It might be worse though when they like know all the words like to every genre. Like, I have XM radio, and there's literally every genre you can imagine. And I have a couple friends like that. I'll just try to like bang out a bunch of different genres real quick, see if they can get them, because it's so ridiculous. Like, it could be like '90s alternative rock, hip hop, reggaeton, like the Disney Channel, and they're just nailing them. I just keep changing the channel. I'm like, really? It's like Dave Matthews on that. It's crazy, I'm thinking, just knowing that the world. One, two, three, into the foe. Snoop Doggy Dogg and Dr. Dre is at the top. Ready to make him. Tú sí quieres controlando, de mi sangre más almándolo. I'm like, oh my god, like, what do I have to do? I'm like, oh, opera station, all right. And then, cuando sono solo, sogno l'orizzonte, manca le parole, try to. Thank you. If you guys didn't realize this already, like, that person is me. I hate myself, man. So embarrassing. Yes, I had to buy a car. It's annoying at this point in life. Like, I now realize how important money is. And, like, I didn't when I was a kid. And I know that very specifically through, like, dumb things. Like, this game I play with my friends. The game where you're like, hey, man, like, how much would it cost for you to do this? Like, it's always something stupid that no one would ever pay you to do. It's the typical one. You'll see some, like, creepy guy across the street. They'll be like, hey, man, like, would you blow that dude for $1 million? And when I was 15, I was like, no, it's disgusting. But, like, as I've gotten older, I've become much more reasonable. I would definitely do that for $1 million. Like, realistically, I'd probably do it for much less. Like, let's be honest here. I think about it. It's like, all right, I do stuff that I hate for $50 an hour. I'm thinking, even if I'm really bad at that, like, I could still finish the dude off in, like, an hour. And now I make $1 million an hour. Like, I'm the highest paid hourly worker in the world. My friend's like, dude, what do you do for a living? I'm like, oh, I'm retired. I used to earn a great hourly wage. I literally, like, fantasize about this happening. Like, I picture some weird dude crossing the street with a suitcase and be like, for $1 million, man, you want to do this? And I would be so excited. Like, I would do anything to try to get the job. I'd be like, sir, if you give me this job, I will blow you and all of your friends. I'm willing to go above and beyond the call of duty to secure this position. It's stupid, too, because nobody would ever pay somebody $1 million to do that. And my friends talk about it like it's really serious. They're like, well, does my girlfriend have to know? I'm like, the first person I would tell is my girlfriend. I go home and I'd be like, babe, the greatest thing ever just happened. She would just start crying tears of joy. And she'd be like, I finally get so many authentic Chanel handbags. Please continue selling your body. Thank you very much, guys. I appreciate it.
Stay tuned for more laughs on Access TV, live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City. John Moses is taking the stage when we return. Welcome back to the Access TV presentation of Gotham Comedy Live. More laughs happening right now.
The second time on Gotham, give a big hand, John Moses.
Guys, the legend, Don Marrero. And I think you fucked my acting coach. It was a woman, relax. Okay, moving on. I just got married. Yes, guys. And there are a lot of reasons why I married my wife. She's a beautiful woman, she's kind, she's generous, she's my best friend, all of that is true. But one of the reasons why I married her is because I know divorce is a thing. I don't know if I'm gonna be able to live with her for the rest of my life, but I do know that I don't have to. I was up there and the reverend was saying, do you take this woman to be your lawful wedded wife through sickness and through health? And I was like, yeah. He goes, and now for the ring, and the ring is a symbol of eternal love. There is no beginning and no end. It just goes on and on and on. And I was like, listen, this is nice and sanctimonious and everything, but my divorced parents are sitting right there. You see that tired, broken down old man that kind of has my face? That's my father. You see the black woman holding his hand? Not my biological mother. That's not her. That's my mom at the other end of the pew, the one with the whiskey bottle poking out of her purse. Which is alarming, because it's an open bar, but here we are. I'm a product of divorce, that's what I know. Everybody in my family that's ever been married has been divorced at least once. My sister's been divorced twice. My cousin's second marriage is hanging on by a prenup.
He doesn't love her anymore, but he doesn't hate her enough to give her $100,000 to fuck off. So he's just stuck there white knuckling it. He's like, aah! And I love my girl, man. I didn't marry her to get divorced. But if the going gets tough, I might get going. And I mean real tough. For better or for worse, has to fall on a scale. And as long as it sort of fluctuates within the norm, you ride that shit out, you know? Like extenuating circumstances. 18 months of unemployment, you don't get divorced over that. You ride it out. You got a mother-in-law that just keeps on living and living and living, Christmas after Christmas, sucking up all your precious family time. Just ride it out. Two glasses of wine a day turns into a crack habit? I gotta go. That sounds drastic, but I'm from Toronto where the last mayor smoked crack, so I feel like anything is possible. If it gets way worse, I gotta go, man, you know? She gains 20 pounds? No big deal. You fuck through it. Maybe Santa slides a yoga mat underneath the Christmas tree next year. She gains 140 pounds, that's another person. If she's gonna start bringing other people into this relationship, well, so am I. I think I got a volunteer over there. She's like, it's me, I'll do it. I don't need $1 million. Just a couple of vodka and tonics. I'm an alcoholic and a drug addict. I quit drinking and doing drugs 8 years ago. Somebody just booed me. You're fucking telling me, pal. Jesus. And I just want to say this. Drinking isn't for everybody. But so is not drinking. I go to meetings. And I was at a meeting the other day, and this old guy comes in, like 75 years old, trembling. He goes, I need to quit drinking. And I was like, now? It's like 3 minutes left in the fourth quarter, and you're down by 30. Now you want to start D'ing up, dude? You got to drink more, man. Put the foot down. Start doing heroin, you know? And I come from a family full of alcoholics, you know? I come from a drinking family. And my dad, he's like a functional alcoholic. Worked hard, two jobs, but weekends, look out, you know? Fridays, come home, 2 in the morning, blacked out, order a pizza. Pizza would get there, he'd throw a slice in someone's face. And go to bed, like, fun, you know? We'd wake up the next morning, he'd be like, who ordered the pizza? We'd be like, Dad, stop it. You know? I was a maniac when I drank. I take after my mother. I used to black out all the time. I black out. I woke up in jail. I woke up in the hospital. I woke up in the middle of a fight with a bouncer 2 seconds before he broke my nose. Do you know what it's like to wake up in the middle of a fight? It's terrifying, man. One time, I blacked out, woke up, making out with a hot chick, blacked back out, woke up 4 hours later, eating out a fat chick. And I finished the job. And that's a good story. Yeah, we got some old school dudes in the back. They know fine dining. My mother's a maniac when she drank, man. And not to get on, my mom's better than your mom on you guys. But my mom could definitely drink your mom under the table. In her prime. She's lost a step or two now. But in her prime, man, she could drink anybody under the table. She drank her husband into the ground. He's dead now. But this is a happy story because he was a wife beater, so she's actually a hero. She's not the hero all you hashtag feminists deserve. She's the dark knight that you need. Fifty years old. Her husband died. Cirrhosis of the liver. Terrible. He's in the bathroom, shit his pants. Just, that was it. EMTs come, load him up on the gurney. And before he died, they're wheeling him out. And they push him past my mom. And he looks at my mom and he goes, am I going to die? And my mom looks at him and goes, probably. Probably? You fucking Clint Eastwood? Is this the end of Unforgiven? Probably? But she didn't know he was gonna die, man, you know? And she felt bad about it. A week after he died, she called me. She goes, John, I didn't know I wasn't gonna see him again. And I was like, I know, Ma. And she goes, he wasn't all bad, John. I go, Ma, if it makes you feel any better, I thought it was hilarious. And she laughed a little bit. 2 months later, she found out he stopped paying on his life insurance policy 5 months before he died. All that sentimental shit was right out the window. She was like, that fucking weasel! Oh, he got me. And they hated each other. They really hated each other. The last 8 years of that marriage, they just fucking hated each other. You know, they were like shut-ins. They were just sitting and drinking each other because they didn't want to embarrass each other outside in the real world, you know? And abusive? Oh, man, he was an abusive little rascal. But she would say some crazy shit. She would say some crazy, crazy shit. I remember one time we were all over there at Christmas time drinking like a family. Me, my brother, my mother and her husband. And for the first hour and a half, it's Christmas. Everything's great, you know? First four drinks. My mom's all jovial. It's like, oh, son, honey, do you need something to eat? You look thin. Come on, you know, get a little more in you. And somewhere between that fourth and fifth drink, like a light switch flipped, you know? The possession began. Her voice dropped a couple of octaves. It's like, ugh. And she looked down at the end of the table at her husband, and she went, I can't remember the last time you touched me, you limp dick faggot. Not a direct quote. I'm paraphrasing a little bit, but the words limp dick and faggot were definitely in there. Like, how do you tell your mom she's got to work on her pillow talk at Christmas, right? It's like... Now, I'm a dude that's of the mind that a man should never hit a woman, right? And it, of course, like, I feel stupid even saying it, but it's the setup. So, especially when that woman is my mother. But ladies, you have to realize, if you say something as crazy as, I can't remember the last time you touched me, you limp dick faggot, the odds of you getting hit goes up exponentially. You throw a little Bacardi on that fire, it's even money, right? That's why when I saw that Ray Rice video, I was like, I gotta hear some audio before I can pass any final judgment. No, is he 99% at fault? 85? I want to know, you know? And I told my mom, I was like, she would call, he's killing me, and we'd send the cops, and she'd send the fucking cops away, and I'd be like, Mom, what are you doing? Just leave. And she goes, what am I supposed to do? Get a job. No, I'm telling you, my mom would rather get hit one day a week than have to suit up and go to work for five. She's like, well, Sundays are rough, but I get to sleep in Monday morning, so it's all good. Guys, I had so much fun, man. My name is John Moses. Thank you very much.
Stay tuned for more laughs on Access TV, live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City.
Thank you. I love you. You're beautiful. What do you call a dog with no legs? Nothing. No matter what you call him, he ain't coming. What do you call a Mexican hitchhiking? Stranded. Come on, folks. Give it a little. A black man and a Puerto Rican are in a car. Who's driving? The police. Ladies and gentlemen, is the sound system working in here? Is this thing on? Is this thing on? Why do you wrap a gerbil in duct tape so when you fuck him, you don't explode? Ooh. How many seconds do I have left, you motherfucker? All right. Let's bring up the cast and crew. Everybody. Thank you. Noel Davis, Karen Morgan, Giuliano Godard, Vegas de Malafacu, and John Moses. Thank you. Tune in next week for a better show. Come on.